Chapter 89. Cutting open the bellies of pregnant women. With Yao Shuliang in pursuit, Chang Hao called up a whirlwind, covering himself and his horse with a dense black smoke. He transformed himself back into his original being, a snake, and spat poisonous gas from his mouth. Yao fell from his horse, and Chang Hao cut his head off. He ran back, shouting, "I'll get Jiang Ziya the same way." Pang Zushou galloped out. "How dare you hurt our great minister?" he yelled back. Seeing that Chang Hao had won the combat, Wu Long could no longer remain patient. He spurred his horse forward with a shout, "Halt! Don't go further away." Pang Zushou and Wu Long fought violently until, after several rounds, Wu Long ran away as if defeated. When Pang Zushou chased after him, Wu Long recovered his original shape, a large centipede, in a burst of wind and black clouds. Pang Zushou was slashed in two when he fainted in the poisonous air. The nobles did not know what had happened. They could only see the black smoke surrounding the enemy and were all very puzzled. Standing beside Jiang Ziya, Yang Jian said to Neja, "As far as I can see, they are not human beings. They look like goblins or sprites. Let's see what they really are." Wu Long ran back. "Who would like to taste my cutlass next?" he shouted. Neja appeared with three heads and eight arms to answer the challenge. He attacked Wu Long, and after three rounds, threw up his nine dragon divine fire coverlet. Wu Long turned into a beam of green light and ran away. Chang Hao ran out again. "Don't go away, Ninja. Here I come," he yelled. When Yang Jian joined the battle, Chang Hao ran away. Yang Jian didn't give chase, but shot a gold ball at him with his bow. He missed, and Ninja tried again with his coverlet. Chang Hao then turned himself into a beam of red light and flew away. Yong Hong was greatly pleased at his general's magic. He ran out with a shout, "Let's decide who's the winner, Jiang Ziya." Yang Ren met him, and after five rounds, took out his five fire divine flame fan and fanned at Yong Hong. But Yuan raced away, leaving his horse to be burnt to death. Jiang Ziya finally ordered the gongs to be struck, signaling the withdrawal of the army. "What a pity that we lost two nobles today," he sighed. Returning to their camp, Yong Hong said, "How terrible are their magic weapons?" Wu Long only smiled. "The coverlet and the fan can do nothing to us. I'm disappointed that we got only two nobles today. We didn't even take Jiang Ziya. I feel very dissatisfied." Yong Hong sent a report to King Zhou on his victory. Lu Rinji said too, "Ying Changxiu, Lei Peng, and Lei Kun. Brothers, did you see our three generals fighting today?" "Yes, but we don't quite understand what happened," they answered. "It's just as the proverb says, good omens will appear when the nation is going to be prosperous. And sprites will appear when the nation is nearing its end. I believe those three generals of ours are all sprites. We are facing the troops of West Qi and the nobles of the whole country. How can those sprites resist them? You should keep this a secret, brother. Let's see what will develop in the next few days," said Ying Chengxiu. "By the grace of this dynasty, I must do my best to serve my country. I'm always ready to dedicate my life to His Majesty," Lu Rinji said. Yong Hong's messenger arrived in Zhaoge with the report to the palace secretariat. Fei Lian received and read the report. He was delighted to learn that Yong Hong had won a great victory in the first combat and immediately took the report to King Zhou. The king was extraordinarily pleased with the report and said, "I'll reward him with a suit of satin, gold, pearls, 100 rolls of Sichuan silk piece goods, and 10,000 strings of cash. Let his generals and soldiers feast on wine and mutton. They should continue to exert their best and wipe out all the rebels. I shall keep my promise to grant them titles and land." Fei Lian kowtowed again to thank the king, as Yong Hong had been recommended by him. Hearing that Fei Lian had delivered a triumphant report from Yong Hong, Daji went over to see King Zhou and said, "I should congratulate you, Your Majesty. Yonghong is really a talented general. With such a great victory behind us, it should be easy to wipe out the rebels in no time at all. It's really a great blessing. I've come to celebrate with you and toast you with wine." The king ordered a feast on the happy terrace to celebrate with his three women. It was the middle of winter, and as they sat there drinking, dark clouds filled in the sky. Snowflakes, like white plum flowers, fell softly to the ground. "Your Majesty, it's snowing," the chief guard announced. "It's perfect for us to enjoy this wonderful scenery," King Zhou said happily. He ordered his attendants to bring more gold cups with warm wine, and they drank again and again. He then ordered the curtains to be opened so all could enjoy the lovely scene outside. The whole city seemed decorated in silver. "My dear queen, you've studied singing and dancing since childhood. Won't you sing a song about the dancing snow for me? I'll salute you with three cups when you've finished," King Zhou urged. On his order, Daji opened her pink lips and a bewitching song floated out over the terrace. King Zhou was so pleased he emptied three cups at once. In a short while, it stopped snowing and the sun shone brightly over them. Leaning on the rail, King Zhou and Daji looked out over the snowy landscape. There was a large ditch to the west which had been dug up to make the foundation of the happy terrace. It was full of freezing stagnant water and difficult to cross. The tyrant and Daji saw an old man cross the canal barefooted. He seemed to ignore the cold and ran swiftly. And then came a young man who also crossed the canal barefooted, but he walked slowly and sluggishly, obviously afraid of the cold. King Zhou turned to Daji. "What a surprise. Did you see, my dear, how the old chap ran quickly across, but the young man just dragged through the cold? It seems quite contrary to reason. Don't you think so, my dear?" he asked her. Daji answered at once. "Can't you see, Your Majesty, that the old man was conceived when his father and mother were young, their lovemaking passionate, and the sperm highly fertile? The old chap was born strong, with good blood circulation and rich bone marrow. Even now, he does not fear the cold and can run quickly through the snow. But the young man must have been conceived when his parents were old and his father's sperm was thin and weak. He is consequently weak and has poor bone marrow. That's why he walks so slowly through the cold." King Zhou smiled and said, "Everyone is fertilized by the father's sperm and nourished by the mother's blood, and everyone is strong in their youth and weak in their old age. How can it be that the old man is stronger and healthier than the young man? You are fooling me, my dear. You may order your guards to bring them here for our study and investigation, Your Majesty," Daji proposed. The king was delighted with her idea and sent his guards after the two men. "Why do you want to stop us?" the two protested. "His Majesty wants to see you," the guards replied. "Don't arrest us. We always obey the law and pay our taxes," they protested again. "You may be lucky and get something out of a meeting with His Majesty," the guards comforted them. When the guards returned with the two innocent citizens, the king ordered, "Cut off their legs and bring them here immediately." When the legs were presented, the king could see the difference in bone marrow between the two men. He patted Daji's back and said, "My dear queen, you really are like a goddess. You know about everything. Although I'm a woman, I've learned enough about the philosophy of positives and negatives that I can see things with great accuracy. It's not at all difficult to survey bone marrow. I can also tell you the sex of fetus, the length of pregnancy, and the position of the infant within a mother's womb," Daji answered. "Since your vision of the bone marrow was so accurate, I certainly believe you could visualize pregnant women correctly," King Zhou said. He then gave an order. "Find some pregnant women in Zhaoge and bring them here." After searching the whole capital, the guards found three pregnant women and brought them to the palace gate by force. Weeping bitterly, they cried, We are pregnant women and decent citizens of Jauga. We have done nothing against the law, and all our taxes are paid. Why are you bringing us to the palace? Their children and husbands clung to them, unwilling to give them up. Everyone was crying and holding one another tightly, but at last the women were dragged into the palace. Jizi, Weizi, Weizichi, Weizian, and Sunrong were sitting in the secretariat's office talking about Yunhong's appointment. When they suddenly heard all the commotion, they rushed out to see what was the matter. Jizi moved forward and asked the women, "Why are you being dragged in here?" The women wept and answered, "We all live in the capital. We've done nothing against the law. Why have we been dragged here? What will you do with such poor women? You are a high minister of His Majesty. You should serve the people and nation faithfully. We beg you to save our lives, though we are lower than the ground you walk on." Jizi immediately asked the chief guard why they'd been brought in, and he replied by telling the story of the bone marrow and the queen's claim to be able to see in a pregnant woman's belly. So, he ordered to me bring three women here for another experiment. The guard concluded. When he had finished, Jizi swore angrily, "You damned tyrant. The enemy troops are just outside the capital. They will be here soon and our dynasty will meet its end. How can you still be deluded by that lewd woman? Don't take them any further." He ordered, "I'm going to admonish the king at once." Jizi, enraged and furious, was followed by Weizi and others to the happy terrace. Jizi knelt on the ground and cried loudly before King Zhou. He admonished him, saying pitifully, "How can the dynasty end so tragically after this many generations?